Hello, everyone. I'm here today to share with you my vision for the future of urban mobility. Often when we think about our cities, we consider mobility as this essential characteristic that somehow demonstrates how healthy our cities actually are. And, you know, we consider advancement in urban mobility and we link it with these big invasive infrastructures that dictate and even dominate our built environment. This goes alongside with digital platforms for optimization and traffic surveillance. But when I think about mobility, I have something slightly different in mind. Our society is evolving and our cities are changing. And I think that the way we live and experience spaces now is more dynamic than ever. Yet the spaces we live and inhabit are as static as they ever were. And I got really fascinated with the way people actually live and inhabit our built environment. I think we can learn so much about our cities if we just look at the way people use them. I've been very, very lucky to live in Barcelona for the last couple of years. And for those of you who've been, you probably noticed it's a very diverse and very vivid and extremely livable city. Excluding the current chaos. But actually what I love about Barcelona is the fact that it's very walkable. I don't drive, and I usually go around either by walking or with a bike. And I noticed that this gives me a very different perspective from a person who would use a private vehicle or, let's say, metro to get around. Actually, I think this gives me a bit of more time to appreciate the quality of space around me. And I started noticing that the same area can have a very, very different life in according to the time of day or season or just whenever there is a particular event. And this truly fascinated me. And I thought, well, I should investigate a little bit further the connection between our built space and the way we live in it. So I started looking at mobility a little bit closer, and something became very clear from the beginning. We are currently in a transitional state. We are moving from our current model to a better connected and shared one. People are more willing now to use vehicles only when needed. And this will definitely have a very great impact on the way we experience and live spaces. I think when we consider the future of mobility, we cannot neglect the fact that technology will have a very great impact, and especially self-driving cars and autonomous vehicles. I believe that they will start freeing up more space for actual functioning public areas. And it's not far from thinking about the future of mobility as something closer to that, where all agents can communicate among each other, and we have a much more dynamic and optimized network, which also leaves a lot more space for living. I believe that in the future, we should consider and we should understand the pedestrian a lot better from what we do currently. And the communication between all agents should be much stronger and more visual. And additionally, once I started researching, there were a lot of questions that came up. And understanding that cities are changing, I thought I want to know a little bit better how are people's behavior in cities changing? And can I track that in a way that it's not privacy invasive? And additionally, can I also implement a certain type of response from our built environment? And I found a solution, or at least at the beginning, I thought, well, you know what? Intelligence should be embedded into the materiality of cities. It should be seamlessly integrated rather than based on plugged-in devices such as cameras. And in order to do all of that, I started with a material system and a very long investigation that can fulfill all of the goals that I had in mind. At the core of this material system stands graphene. For those of you who don't know, graphene is the first ever synthesized two-dimensional material. It has great potential to revolutionize many fields, and I truly believe that architecture should be one of them. It has all these outstanding properties, but for my research, it was particularly interesting to work with its extreme conductivity in terms of both electricity and heat. with graphene, I was able to synthesize a set of conductive inks and composites that were programmable and super stable. Then I could deposit these conductive inks on plastic sheets to create active surfaces, or I could embed them into almost any dielectric material to create active modules or tiles. Of course, as I was looking for an urban application, I went on with the modular approach, and I just took a Barcelona normal tile from the street, casted it, and this was the first step of my investigation. After many iterations, I actually got to this. This is a tile that can sense human interaction and can respond accordingly. It can emit light, it can heat up, and it can even vibrate in order to direct and guide blind people in our urban areas. The system was then optimized, and as it's modular, it can be quite easily replaced, and each module can sort of inform if there is a problem with it. It was then optimized in order to be energy efficient, because these things should cover really, really big areas. What is the difference between the system I'm trying to develop and any other type of data gathering device, because essentially this is what it is? It's the fact that it equally includes all agents. And it does that in a very private manner. We don't get identification of the users, but we still do get a lot of information that we as architects and urban planners can find extremely useful. So after analyzing the raw data, we can understand the engagement rate that the person has with each area of our city. And in order to start applying that into an actual city scale, of course, there are several extents. And I believe that we should start with just strategic locations, such as crossing points, main streets, or public plazas, where we truly want to understand people's behavior. But once the system becomes applied into greater areas, then we can actually start answering the questions, why do people behave the way they do? Why some areas are more social and people walk in groups, whereas others, people walk alone and have their time of solitude? Why there are areas where people rush through? And what is the reason that others, we stop and we look around? In order to showcase a little bit better what the system actually does, I chose Barcelona once again. Not only because I really enjoy the city, but because it's, as I mentioned, extremely walkable. So much so that 49% of all trips are done by foot. Barcelona is also currently trying to implement strategies for urban development and for prioritizing pedestrians while reclaiming some of the space that we use for private vehicles and collecting 9 blocks of the urban grid into the so-called super block. So I chose a small study area in the neighborhood of Poblenou. It is the area where the first super block is actually situated, and I wanted to understand exactly how does the transition of this area from an industrial to a more mixed use and residential actually affect human behavior. I was able to create a simulation with which I actually proved that the Superia is a more efficient and more human area than the rest within Poblenou. Then I was able to start breaking down the data, going from each day of the week and understanding if weekdays and weekends have different dynamics. Of course, in order to truly understand why is the reason for all of this pedestrian behavior, we should start overlapping different layers of data, starting, of course, with the ground floor and the way that the different areas are located and the strategy of the ground floor. Additionally, we can simulate climate data such as wind or solar radiation, traffic data that is almost openly available in most European cities, and on top of that, having the newly gained pedestrian activity data. Having all of those together, we can start understanding, do people really choose areas without wind in order to walk around? Do they detour from the shortest path just because they want to pass by a greener area? Or do maintenance work really affect the way that we choose our morning road to work. Finally, I just think that as architects, we often design spaces that guide people. And we might consider moving to spaces guided by people. I believe that the tool that I'm trying to create can be very beneficial in order to understand behavior better and to design more human cities. Thank you.